Noyer, I'm from Leipzig, PhD student, and I'm going to present you part of my PhD, which is called PUMA. It's a comprehensive cache used to pool and use memory in virtual machines. So this was it was a few years ago. Applications were deployed on bare metal machines. So basically, you have a in a cluster, you have hosts. Connected with a very good network, and you have applications that were sharing the same memory. Basically, you have memory-intensive applications that use classical allocation, such like Memalloc. So this is what we call anonymous pages, and you have I/O-intensive applications that use page cache. So in this example, memory-intensive applications are in red, and I/O-intensive applications are in green. So now, with the cloud computing, for example, we have a lot of use of virtual machines. So basic idea is to isolate the most applications in virtual machines. So this allows more for flexibility and isolations, but the problem is that it fragments memory. In this example, we have applications that were isolated, I guess, as the best option. And we have an application that is swapping and another application. Here, that is a memory-intensive application, but as you can see, there is no memory available for cache. So this is an application that will be very slow. The problem here is that it's very easy to share CPU time with the scheduler. However, with the memory, it's very difficult to dynamically add more memory or remove memory to a VM, depending on the real needs of a VM. So one solution for such kind of issues, it's memory ballooning. Basic idea is to have some memory pinned into the VMs. When a VM needs more memory, it will try to deflate the balloon, and this means I need more memory, and I ask for to the hypervisor to have more memory, and then the hypervisor will try to get more memory within another VM, so it will inflate the balloon to give the memory to the first VM. So there is a limitation. The problem is that the page cache is still fragmented. For example, as we can see this figure on the other hosts, there is still free memory. Actually, this is cache memory, but unused memory. There is no application that needs this cache anymore. The other issue is that when you give memory to another VM, if you need this memory back, you will swap. So to illustrate this, we made a simple experiment with KVM and an automatic ballooning patch. Basic idea of this experiment is to make a lot of I/O on the first VM so that the balloon will decrease and thus take the memory of the other VM. And on the other VM, after all, we make memory allocations. And when we will do the memory allocations, we will need more memory. So we want to get back our memory. But since it is very difficult for the hypervisor to know that all the memory he had taken was for cache, he will give swap to the VM. At goal, we have memory allocations that are very, very slow. On this figure, some of them take more than 1 second to complete. And this is when the memory allocation does not crash the application. So our approach is to make a cooperative page cache. So it relies in part on the clean cache API for one who knows it. Basically, it is agnostic to hypervisor, file systems, and block device, and also to applications. Since we are into the Linux kernel, almost all applications that need more cache can take benefit of Puma. The other idea is that we act only on clean cache pages. First, because writes are generally non-blocking, so this is, it will be very difficult to improve the performance of such such I/O. And if we want to handle writes, we will need to handle very complex consistency scheme. And the other idea is that if we only put clean pages into the cooperative cache, it will be very easy to reclaim them. Just drop them and you can get your memory back. So as I said, it's built on the part of the clean cache API. Basically, we have two operations, the put and the get. Put operation, the basic idea is to put a victim page into the cooperative cache. This is habitually triggered by memory allocation to the application. And this allocation will trigger the page frame reclaiming algorithm, which will try to find the victim page into the page cache. In this example, we will choose the page 31. When it has chosen this page, our job is to keep some metadata into memory to know that we will put this page into the cooperative cache. And then we send it to the cache. It is done almost asynchronously because we actually send a copy of the page to the cache and we give the victim page, the real page to the application. And then the page is stored into the remote VM, directly into the system page cache of the remote VM. The second operation, it's a get operation. So we want to get back a page that was sent previously into the cache. So this is actually a miss into the cache. So when we want to read a new data from the block device, before going to the block device, we'll test into the metadata if we know that the page has been sent into the cache. If this is the case, we send a request to the remote VM, and then it sends back the page. So we implemented two caching strategies. The first one is an exclusive one. Basic idea is that when you get a page, you remove it immediately from the remote cache. So you have more memory because you have the local memory plus the remote memory. The second scheme, it is called a non-inclusive caching strategy. Basic idea is to keep the page. Because you may want to send this page again in a few times if this is chosen as a victim page. And in this case, as the page is already present in remote cache, you don't have to send it. So we'll see after that it may be a good thing to performance. One important thing is to control sequential IOs. Because such IOs may be painful for the performance. Sequential bandwidth from hard drive may be better than the network bandwidth first. And secondly, the cost of sending a large stream over the network may be very expensive because we may use all the bandwidth, or we may use all the CPU time needed to send off all of the first data. So basically, the problem here is to detect when we do not want to send a page because we guess that it is a sequential stream. For that, we rely on the existing read ahead algorithm. Our idea is to tag each pages that is read through the read ahead algorithm. So we still, so it's a heuristic because a page may be read first time through a stream and then a second time in a random manner. So for the first time we tag it, and when it is chosen as a victim page, we do not send it to the cache. Okay, so it was for the first part is when we read a page, so we tag it, And when you have to evict a search page, we know that it has been tagged previously, so it has been read in a sequential manner, and we decide to not send it to the cache. This is a way to focus only on random accesses so that we do not fill all the remote cache with a large stream. So there is a few implementation details that are important to us. First, it is the response time, because we rely on a fast network, and especially, particularly on the low latency network. If the latency is very variable, we may actually decrease the performance of the application. So for that, we monitor the network latency, and we disable our mechanism if the response time becomes too high. Second difficulty is the memory footprint, because we have to keep some data locally, but if we keep a lot of data for each page sent to the network, we maybe use more memory than if we just don't use the mechanism. To do that, we have an amortized 64 bits per page cost, which means almost 2 megabytes of metadata for each gigabyte of cache used remotely. If we need to get back to our memory that we landed to another VM, it's very easy, because we just have to drop the page that we host. This is easy because we only manage clean pages into the cache. So if we drop them, the first VM that asked for my memory, we just need to read it from disk. Another issue is to avoid deadlocks in our mechanism. Basic idea is that we want to send memory page to the other VM, but we are into a memory climb path. So the problem is that if we need to allocate memory to send the page, we will maybe need to reprogram more memory and so on. So to avoid that, we use a lot of atomic memory allocations, and we rely on a pretty small memory pre-allocated memory pool. For instance, we use a pool of 16 megabytes. And for all the consistency, in the clean cache API, all the dirty pages are first written to disk before going through this API, so we don't have consistency issues. And we've made some experiments with KVM. And those experiments, we use a client-server model, where we have a server that acts at a remote cache server, and a client with a fixed 1 gigabyte memory. And we have a baseline. This is basically just a single memory, so the client without remote cache. We use various benchmarks, micro benchmarks, and database applications. In this presentation, I will present only three of those experiments. The first of all is to vary the workload on the server side. So this is to see if we are able to reclaim the memory that we landed to the first VM. Then we've made some experiments with co-localized VM, so just we take benefit of the parvertalized network between VMs. And then we injected latency between VMs to see how we are able to manage the response time. So for the first experiments, we compare to the baseline, we allocate memory without any mechanisms that can increase the allocations. We compare to the ballooning approach that was presented previously. And we see that with Puma, we have only a small cost when we want to reclaim the memory. This is like 10 times faster than with an automatic ballooning approach. And then with sequential I/O filtering. So in this graph, we show for BLAST, this is a biologic tool that has a large part of his workload that is sequential. And we can see that when we filter all the sequential IOs, we only send a small part of the dataset that is really randomly intensive to the cache, and we are able to improve the performance here by up to 40%. So with databases, databases are known to have a large part of random IOs. And as we can see, when we filter the sequences, we can pretty easily get large performance improvements. That's all. This is with network latency injection. So we use NetM to inject latency. Zero means no latency injection. So this is our baseline. It was like 200 microseconds latency between VMs. And as we can see, when we add latency, after 1 millisecond of injected latency, the Puma is disabled. And so there is no speed up because Puma is disabled, but there is also no slowdown. So to summarize, we presented Puma. This is a mechanism to pull unused memory between virtual machines. So this is between virtual machines, but it may be used between physical hosts. It does not depend on a hypervisor. As it is a kernel-based mechanism, it allows to use any application that is IO-intensive to improve its performance. So, thank you. Question? Actually, I don't know. So the question is why it was not done before. I mean, actually, it was done before with distributed shared memory, for example. We take the problem in another point of view. We think that as we have more and more VMs into the same host, we can take benefit of a large bandwidth and a very low latency between VMs. But we also saw that some company have a private cloud, for example, with a few clusters, and they may take benefit of the unused memory of other VMs. So actually, from a context point of view, we focus more on VM issues. I guess for bare metal performance with application deployed directly on a physical host, this may be one solution. So, yep.
So fundamentally, running this device VM can direct memory to fire the
loop. Yeah.
And the problem with the loop is that it's not back. Remember,
yeah, we thought about that. Actually, what we do with Puma is not to give memory, is to lend memory. This is why I said that we send copy of pages. This is why it is very easy to reclaim that, because we own the pages, but actually not the data that is in it. With ballooning, the problem is difficult because if you want to be agnostic to the VM, this is another problem. Actually, the real problem with ballooning is that hypervisor does not know what is inside the memory of the VM. So it's difficult to synchronize all the VM and to decide which VM will give its memory to the other VM. Whereas with Puma, we are only in the other part, only into the VM, so we know that our memory is used for cache, and it may be useful or not. First.
Just a remark regarding the low part of the memory. Are we really winning something? Because it's pretty easy to have a lot of memory one side. And a second remark is, have you compared the system, which is almost working on another node using the network? Did you benchmark it versus just working locally on a good disk?
Not with swapping, but we compared with a swap on a SSD, and the performance are almost in the same order of magnitude, except for writes that are much better into the SSD. I mean, for writes that are on when flushed, because it's very much faster to write on a SSD than into a magnetic disk. But on the other part, it was more efficient to make accesses to the remote network, to the VM through the remote network than an SSD.
But it was on the empty 10 gig links. There is no networking, which is pretty high-class level networking.
Yeah, no, 10 gigabit network, it's not so high-class. Plus, on the same host with a parameterized network, it's free to have a good network between VMs on a single host.
Yeah, I
agree. And for your first question about the price of memory, we made these experiments with almost small VM because we at lab we don't have so much memory, but it works with very big database and big memory. So when you need a I don't know, hundreds of gigabytes of memory, it is not so cheap. I mean.
Did you try the behavior when you load all the VMs at the same time, when there is conference on all the systems at the same time, and not one by node on one?
Yeah, no. But I guess that the latency will become higher and the mechanism will stop. Yeah, you have to calibrate it experimentally before. It depends on your platform, on your physical host, on your resources. Yeah, this is what I said. The better performance you can get is with a single host because we'll take benefit of the parameterized network between VMs. So this means like a very huge bandwidth and low latency. Questions? Thank you.